In this video, we'll go through a real-world diagnosis and repair of a sailboat bilge pump problem. We'll illustrate a functional layout of how these systems work, and we'll do a little autopsy of what's inside a modern automatic bilge pump.
Good morning, guys. Well, I got a little emergency problem here on the boat, and I thought I'd take you along. Yesterday, we were sailboat racing, and we were unusually slow. And I went downstairs to put a jacket on, and I noticed all this water slopping around on the floor. And as I looked at it more closely, I realized that the button for manual activation of the sump pump was not lit. And so I realized my sump pump had died for some reason. And so we finished the race, and while guys were putting away the sails, I came down and ripped up the floorboards to get at the sump pump.
So the switch for manual activation of the sump pump is right here. And no matter which direction I'd turn that little switch, I wouldn't get that light to turn on. First thing I did is I checked this fuse, and this fuse is five, little 5-amp fuse is fine. But to my surprise, this light doesn't come on. Now this light should come on even if the sump pump is bad, and so I suspected that we had some kind of a short somewhere. Now the next thing I notice is that these wires are numbered. This is number 21 here, and I can show you where that number 21 leads to, where it ties into the battery positive system. Well, when you work on a boat, you come out with surprises then, because there are repairs that are stacked on top of previous repairs, and indeed, to my surprise, look what I found a little fuse holder on this wire number 21. And opening this up, I realized that there's a little glass fuse in here which is blown. And so that's easy enough, I replaced that fuse. Let's have a look at the switch again and see what that does. So for this next part, I'm going to use my power probe, but you don't need a power probe to do this. You could easily do it with a multimeter. The power probe just makes things easier. Now the power probe is tied into the battery with the negative and the positive, and so the tip of that tells us, using the system's multimeter, as to what's going on. So it's basically a simple multimeter. But on top of that, you can actually apply either power or ground to that tip, depending on what you want to do for diagnosis. But we're just going to use the multimeter function for now. So let's come over here. And let's just see what we've got here for power and ground. And so 13.7 volts. So that's our battery positive. And no power here. And no power there. And then we've got 13.7 volts there. And so what that tells us is that this fuse is good. And let's have a look at the switch. Now to do that, I'm gonna need a couple of alligator clips, so I'll just put those on now. Okay, so now let's check out the automatic feature of this. Here's my power probe. I've got it tied into that red line there. And then, so that gives me 13 volts there. So that tells me that the auto portion of that switch works fine. And then that you'll switch over to the manual, and let's see how the manual works. And the manual works fine as well. So what we've proven is this switch is good. Let's go down to the sump and see if power is getting there. Now the evidence is growing that this sump pump is bad, and so I've taken the next step of cutting the wires leading to the sump pump. And now we're going to check the wires individually. Now this black one should be a ground, and so if I touch this, I should get a constant ground. And I do, that's 0 volts, so that ground is good. Now I want to check the individual wires. The yellow wire is the one leading to manual control. And so I'm going to just hook this up here, and then I'm going to go and turn the switch on, and you watch for me. We'll see if the power shows up at that thing when I flip the switch. So manual control is working, and now let's go to automatic and see if automatic is good. There, you watch for me. Excellent. So here's the circuit we have. Most bilge pumps and boats have a manual pump hooked up to a separate float switch, which is quieter and less expensive, and when things go wrong, you replace only the part you need. But it requires more free space in the bilge. In this case, we have a more compact automatic pump that electronically measures impedance to decide when to shut off. You just get used to the sound of the pump coming on every 3 minutes for a few seconds, and it doesn't drain the battery power as much as you'd think.
Now here's a question. Supposing I had a big area of resistance upstream, like a frayed or a corroded wire, barely making contact, either on the power or the ground side, what would the voltmeter have shown in the tests I've done so far? If you think there'd be a problem in the wires, what would you do next? This would be a perfect topic for the discussion thread, but I want to move on. In this case, I decided to come at the problem from the opposite angle, completely bypassing the wiring to independently prove the pump is bad.
Okay, now let's check the pump. Now these systems, these automatic pumps, have three wires. One is the ground, one is the one for manual activation, one's for automatic activation. I'm measuring ohms between the automatic activation and ground, and not surprisingly, we've got OL. It's an open circuit there. So now let's check the other one. Let's go to the manual. And look at this, we've got 3.5 ohms. So that's pretty small. That's a pretty small resistance. And so it means current there is going to be pretty significant when we put current to it. It's we'll have to see if it works. So now I've bypassed the switch entirely. I've hot-wired the ground back to the battery. I'm going to immerse this into the water. And when I apply power with the power probe, it should spit water. Let's see what happens. Push this so you can see it. Nothing. Nothing. Here's the manual resistance to ground on the new pump. I love this little soldering iron by power probe. The only issue with it is that it sometimes can be a little bit too fast. Dang, I thought it'd be simple. Watch this. See all that extra water right there? We've got a leak in our pipe somewhere. I'm gonna have to chase that down. All right, here's our leak here. I guess two issues. One is I'm surprised to see no hose clamps, and then the second thing is I thought this would be all one piece. Maybe they had to do this because the opening was too small or it was too tight. In any case, I'm going to take this apart and see if I can replace the whole thing. All right, let me show you something. I'm going to have to do this handheld because I can't get back far enough from the tripod. Here's our bilge pump here, and it pumps water through this hose that we're going to replace up to here, and then you lose it behind the board, and you can pick it up again here, and it goes out through this through-hole, which I've got closed off at the moment. Now, imagine if the boat was heeled over to that side. One could conceivably siphon ocean water back into the boat if the check valve inside this pump were to fail, or if the hose were to break for some reason. And so all of these systems need to have an anti-siphon loop. Now, there's no room to put one here. And also on a sailboat, you don't want to have it on the side because it can heel over to that side and your anti-siphon loop needs to continuously above the waterline. And so what they've done is they put it inside the sink here. I'm going to take you over and show you another view of it. So here's our sink, and underneath the sink, we've got this situation. Now the hose that we're looking at, the hose we're going to replace, is this one right here. And here's our anti-siphon loop right there behind. Can you see it? And if you look deep inside there, you can actually see the anti-siphon valve. Now I'm going to take that off and we're going to blow into it and make sure it's patent. But that valve relieves the suction. If you get negative pressure on this anti-siphon loop, the valve opens and it allows air into it to break the siphon and make it less likely that you're going to siphon seawater back into your boat. There's the other end of the hose there that goes up to the through hole. And then incidentally, we can see the through hole for the sink as well. Interestingly, notice there's no trap on this sink. If you put something down the sink, it goes straight out to the ocean with no chance of recovery of any rings or anything. All right, now I've unhooked it and pulled it out so I can get better access to it. And then I'm just gonna unscrew this. These things are just one-way valves. I'm gonna clean it off first with an air filter on the top here. And basically, if you suck on it, it should allow air in, but it shouldn't allow air out when you blow on it. Brought this yellow Teflon tape along just to show you what not to use. This is for oil and gas. You want to use the white ones, dead cheap. And you just put this on clockwise so that when you put the screw on, it tends to tighten it up. Unfortunately, I'm facing a little bit of a conundrum here. With the modifications that Jay did on this keel, they ended up with a sump area which is quite tight. Now, even though I've used exactly the same model, or at least the updated model of the pump, this one no longer fits. And the reason is they had a hose barb here, but instead of a hose barb, what they added is a threaded connection and then a backflow preventer. You can see it right there. You see that little Y-shaped thing. And if I put this on, there's not enough room to set it properly. And in particular, I'm concerned that with the positive voltage that's coming in here, I don't want to have anything that's continuously immersed in water that might contribute to galvanic corrosion. And so I added in this brass elbow. I hope it works. I'm going to slop it with all kinds of sealer with the hope that it seals the threads properly. And then this end goes on here. Wish me luck. I hope this works. If it doesn't work, I may end up having to use a different area, but that looks like it'd be a lot of work as well. Measure twice, cut once. All right, with difficulty, I got it on the hose onto the hose barbs on each side. It was really tight, and so eventually I ended up using steam to warm it up a little bit. A hairdryer probably would have been better. The heat gun can overdo it on those things. Well, we've got a partial success here. We've got manual control. Watch this. When I hit manual, it drains nicely. My flow is good, and I've got no leaks on either side. Listen to the anti-siphon valve grunt as it shuts off. You hear that? So a bit of a funny quirk in the software. Once it shuts off because it's run dry, it looks like it closes itself out for 3 minutes, even if it's subsequently down. Drowned. You notice the sensor is completely underwater. It should be draining now, but it's shut out. It's not draining. And I think that what's going to happen here is at about the 3 minute mark, it's going to suddenly wake up and turn itself on. A bit of a quirk in the system. I don't know if I really like that, because you know, you could be desperately trying to bail your boat out. On the other hand, if it is able to catch up, it's not an urgency. And anyway, there we are. 2 minutes and 30 seconds, and it turns itself back on. So here's the brains of the system. Ground comes in here 100% of the time, and power comes in on this brown wire 100% of the time. And this is the manual control that allows you to just put power directly to the motor.
These two white wires lead to a thermal shutdown fuse to protect from overheating. And you can see the impeller at the bottom.
Now, just about every DC motor made will draw more current, more power, when it's under load compared to when it's not. And the microelectronics here are designed to detect that and keep the motor spinning as long as it's pushing against a load. And so you can see there's a little microprocessor right here. There's a relay and a series of diodes and capacitors and resistors that help to make that decision.
Taking a closer look at the electronics, there's some old flux left behind on the final solder joints, but very little evidence of water intrusion on the board, oxidation, overheating, cracked solder joints, or electronic failure at all.
So power to the motor comes on these two pins here, one here, one here. Those are the ones I just desoldered. So it looks like the water intrusion came through the impeller side, creating all this rust. And you notice, as we expected, this is a permanent magnet motor. Let's measure the resistance of the windings. 2.9 ohms. There is some mechanical resistance. It's certainly not free spinning. Right there. And those brushes will make contact with the commutator here. Interestingly enough, this armature seems to have 5 poles. Not sure why I thought it was more likely to be an even number, but in any case, 5 poles it is. Okay, I've taken the magnets out, and you can see all the rust and corrosion there, and the same thing inside there. So with these autopsy findings in mind, I'd say that this old pump wore out its lower bushings. The bottom seal leaked, letting bilge water contaminate the lower motor area, but not the electronics. That led to increasing mechanical resistance and probable overheating, and then higher current draw, ultimately leading to a blown fuse. Okay, well, it's all good. I'm really pleased with how things are working. I'm sure you were shocked as well to discover this disgraceful little stub of metal where it shouldn't have been, but we couldn't have found it at a better time, as opposed to a situation when you're in an emergent situation and suddenly the pump fails. We fixed that without complication, and overall things are going well. Now, I should mention as well that the pigtail on the pump was long enough that it allowed me to zip tie the soldered areas well up and out of the way of the bilge, and so they're not going to be immersed in water and a potential cause of galvanic reactions. Say, if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, then hit like or subscribe or leave a comment. I'd love to hear what others say. Thanks for watching.